Church, would you stand? We're going to worship together this morning. you, Jesus. Yes, I thank you, Lord. Oh, we thank you for your presence, Lord. There's a table. There's a table that you've prepared for me in the presence of my enemies. It's your body and your blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battles. There's a table, there's a table. This is how I fight my battles, and I believe you've overcome, and I will lift my song of praise for what you've done. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. Abiding in you is where we find our strength. In your presence, Lord, we praise you, we praise you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but
You can't be controlled. You can't be measured by what we know. Your love is forever. It won't run dry. And
should go back to that bridge. He can't be contained. There's so much fear in the world today, but our God is bigger. Our God is bigger.
Can't be contained. You can't be contained. You can't be controlled. You can't be measured by what we know. Your love is forever. It won't run dry. And only you will satisfy.
Come on, church, this is the truth today. no saddle you won't ride up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me, it's coming. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Come on, there's no shadow, there's no shadow you won't. Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall, there's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. It only overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it changed. Chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99, and I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Every voice, there's no shadow. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. One more time. There's no shadow you won't light up.
Can you imagine, with all of the faith in the room, what the Lord can do? And it's gonna happen, just let the Waymaker through, He's gonna move, yeah. And can you imagine, with all of the faith in the room, what the Lord
to deny what the Lord can do. And you are more than able. You are more than
worship you, Lord. We just worship you, Lord. We just set our heart on you. We just focus on your presence. We're focusing on your presence. Ready to take the bread and the cup, communion this morning. Communion is about what we've just been singing. Communion is about what Jesus has won for us and what Jesus has done and is doing for us. I want you to think about that song. He is more than able. And before we even take these elements of communion, if you're here this morning and you have a need, I want you to know that that's not just a song. That's a reality. If he is more than able, because communion celebrates what he won for us, the fact that he freed us from our sin, the fact that he broke the chains that held us down. And it's about what he's done and is doing for us, that he is able to take care of any situation in your life this morning, any sickness or disease that you're battling, any place in your life where there is need for provision. He is more than able. And who are we to be in this place today and say, you can't do it, Jesus? Stop saying to yourself, it can't happen. Stop saying to yourself, it won't happen, and start declaring, you are more than able. It can happen. It will happen, because I am connected to the King of Kings and the Lord of the Lords, and he is the one who has won it for me and done it for me. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Paul says this: we have peace with God. We have everything we need because of what he has done for us. In Ephesians 1:7, it says, he is so kind. I want you to hear that this morning. Jesus is so kind that he himself purchased our freedom with his blood. And he forgives us of our sins. And he meets our every need. This morning, with your eyes closed, what is the point of need in your life right now? What do you need Jesus to do for you? As we come to the table of the Lord, he's already won it. He's already done it. What do you need for him to manifest in your life? Do you need a physical healing this morning? Then right now, ask him for it. You don't need anybody to lay hands on you to pray for you. He can do it right where you are. Do you need provision in your life? As we're at the communion table, ask him. Psalm 23 says, behold, you have prepared a table before me in the presence of my enemies. It doesn't matter what's going on in your life. The Lord has prepared a table, a banqueting feast for you this morning. There's something that he wants to give you, something that he wants to do for you, something that he wants to put in you that helps you to overcome, that causes you to be victorious. Ask him right now in this moment for whatever you need. Maybe it's a family problem. Maybe it's a relational issue. Maybe it's your job. Whatever is weighing heavily on you, he is more than able. Maybe it's a lie that you've been believing about God or about yourself or about your situation, and you need the Holy Spirit to reveal truth. You need that lie to be broken. Jesus, today I thank you that you have not only won it for us on Calvary, but you've done it, and you continue to do it. You continue to be faithful. Lord, I pray right now that you would move throughout this room and you would begin to meet the needs. You hear every prayer that's being uttered in this moment. God, you see every tear that's being shed over some situation in this moment. You see the pain that's in this room and the pain of those that are watching online, and you are more than able to meet the need, whatever it is. And so I'm asking you to meet the need right now. I'm asking you to send out your healing touch. I'm asking, Lord, to release provision. I'm asking you to heal broken hearts. I'm asking you, Lord, to knock down every lie of the enemy that is ensnared and trapped and imprisoned your people. I am asking you, Lord, to light up the dark places. I'm asking you, Lord Jesus, to move in this place right here, right now, to move across the airwaves to those online right here, right now. We believe that you're in this room. We don't have to beg you to come. We just need to recognize that your presence is already here. You have been waiting to heal us. You have been waiting to speak to us. You've been waiting to pour out your Spirit. So Jesus, have your way in us. Who are we to deny what you can do? Who are we to say you can't or you won't? Lord, today we believe. We believe you can and you will, because you've won it and you've done it on Calvary. So I thank you, Jesus, for what you're doing right now in this moment. People's lives. Encounter us. Do a work in our hearts and our lives. Help our unbelief. Jesus, we need you. We need you. We long for you. You are the only answer. I invite you to take the bread and the cup right now. And as you take it, remember that he won it for you. He won heaven for you on the cross. He has done it for you. He has promised to give you everything you need. So receive these elements with gratitude. Lord, even as we're receiving these elements, I pray for the situation in our world right now. I pray for the situation in the Middle East. I pray for the situation in America, Lord. I pray, God, that even tomorrow, as this eclipse happens all over the earth, that, Lord, you would just guide and direct, that you would orchestrate this season in history. God, I pray that your people would not be afraid, but they would rise up in the power of the Spirit. And in this dark hour, that we would be your light to the world. That we would demonstrate your love and your kindness. No matter what's going on all around us, may you fill us with your grace. God, may you protect us and keep us. God, we put our trust in you as we're looking at all of these events and all of these predictions and all of these things we are reminded that while some trust in chariots and some trust in their horses, we will trust in the name of the Lord our God, and we will not be shaken, nor will we be moved. Because you are in control of it all, and you reign above it all, everything that's happening in our world today. We trust you, and we love you, Jesus. And we thank you for all that you've done. Amen and amen. Amen. Thank you for worshiping with us today. Turn around and greet your neighbor, if you would, and just take a moment to say hello. Encourage someone near you. Get to know someone new, maybe a guest or whatever.
Good morning, Life Church. Welcome, welcome. Good to see you all in the house this morning. My name is Nick Gazzardo, Associate Pastor here at Life Church. Just wanted to greet you this morning and give you a couple quick announcements and let you know if you're visiting with us, if it's the first time or you've been visiting for even a couple weeks or a couple months, you consider yourself kind of new to the house and you haven't introduced yourself to us yet. We want to get to know you. We've got a visitor kiosk out in the lobby. We'd love to meet you there. We have a gift bag for you with an incredible book, a life-changing book that has changed my life. We want to put that into your hands and just bless you and answer any questions you have about Life Church. And a couple quick announcements. Coming up quickly, how many of you are loving spring that is in the air right now? I am loving it. We're, as we usually do around spring, for all of the green thumbs in the house and the handy men and women who love to get out and start their tan and get their fingers dirty, get their hands in the soil, we have a spring cleanup day coming at both of our campuses here at Roscoe and Rockford on Saturday from 9 to noon. Coming up, we'll be doing all kinds of things. So we normally do picking up branches, cleaning up the flower beds, spreading mulch, raking up, you know, organizing the rocks. And all kinds of things, cleaning windows, all kinds of things, and working on some of the equipment here at our campuses. So if you're handy and you're ready to get out and help clean up our campuses, get signed up for that. See myself or Pastor Dan, and we'll get you down on the list. We just kind of want to know who's coming so we can prepare for that day at both campuses. And you, Neil Strawbridge will be leading down at South. Pastor Dan and I will be leading here at North. But we're going to make the house beautiful and ready for the spring. Amen? That was kind of weak. Okay, that's much better. Thank you. This makes me nervous. I don't want to do this alone. We are better as a team. The next quick announcement, if you've been praying about your missions pledge for the 24-25 calendar year from April to April, and you want to support our missionaries around the world who are doing incredible work, and you're praying about that pledge, you still have time to fill out that missions pledge card. Out in the lobby, there are cards available, and you can fill that out, turn that in at any time, or you can use the Realm Connect app and submit your pledge offering that way as well. We just want to just get those numbers in so we know where we're at for this next year as we're budgeting to support our missionaries. And lastly, we just want to continue our worship this morning with our tithes and offerings. Ushers, if you can come forward and help me do that. We want to serve the house this morning. And you can give old school. You can write a check. You can drop cash into the baskets when they come by, or use the QR code and do that electronically. That's a very secure way to give. I did it while I was in Egypt on the other side of the planet. Worked perfectly. We love the technology. It makes us easy and fast so we can give. But we want to just remember why we give this morning. Just a quick word of encouragement to remind you every single week in this house here in Roscoe and down at our South Campus and in life groups that meet throughout the week and on our Wednesday night Equip Night, all kinds of classes. There are resources flowing out of this house to the body of Christ right here in this campus and at South Campus and to our community to minister the good news of the gospel to people who need it, to teach people the truth of God's word, to minister to the youth, to minister to married groups, to minister to families and life groups. There's ministry flowing out of the house in all directions, but it all takes the resources of the house to minister to the house and to the community. Amen. All of that takes us doing it together. So as you give this morning, just give remembering that. You don't always see it with your eyes physically, but know that it is happening. So much ministry pouring out of this house, and it's because of the goodness of God and the faithfulness of his people. Amen. So Father, we thank you for the opportunity to give this morning. We thank you that we give in obedience to you because you first gave to us. You provided everything we need. And your call is to simply take 10% and sow it right back into the house, into the community, into the work that you're doing in us and through us. We thank you that we get to be a part of the work of the ministry happening all over this city. Bless the giver and multiply the gift in Jesus' name. Amen. Here's your announcement video.
All right, announcements. Hello and happy Sunday, friends. My name is Rico. Welcome to Life Church. We're excited to have you here with us today. Here are your announcements for Sunday, April 7th. Water baptism is a powerful expression of one's commitment to Christ. It's an act that symbolizes dying to one's old nature and being born again as a new creation. We are holding water baptisms during service next Sunday on April 14th at the North Campus. If you would like to be baptized, register on Realm today. Encounter is a night of powerful worship and impactful prayer as we enjoy the presence of God together. Our next Encounter night is on Sunday, April 21st at 6 p.m. at the North Campus. We'd love for you to join us.
Hey everyone, you already know who we are. You know what we're asking for.
It is Fuse Camp time. And if you don't know what Fuse Camp is, let me introduce you. Fuse Camp is our event that we do in Rockford. And it is a camp that we put on for over 200 kids.
Yeah.
It is all about reaching them for Jesus. It is about giving them meals every day that they might not get. And it's about having a ton of fun. But it is a huge event.
So that is where you come in. We need all hands on deck from both Roscoe and Rockford campuses for this event. All we are asking for is one day at a time. If you were able to give us one day or even half a day, that would be absolutely amazing and help us out so much. So if you go on Realm or go out into the lobby, there is a list of the different positions that are available for you to help with.
If you want to sign your kid up for Fuse Camp, please sign up quickly because guess what, guys? Spots are filling up fast. We can only have 200 kids and we have almost half of them already gone.
Yeah.
So whether you volunteer or you want to attend as a kid, please make sure you sign up today.
Thank you.
If you want to stay caught up on what's up at Life Church, follow us on social media and the Realm Connect app so you can stay in the know, on the go. Here's this week's message. Enjoy the rest of your service. The words danger, do not touch are probably terrifying to read in Braille.
Good morning, everybody. How's your week been? Some of you, it's great. Others, you're like, I'm here. That's good enough, right? Welcome to those of you joining us online as well as we start a brand new series called Out of the Cave. Have you ever experienced emotions that were so overwhelming and so strong in your life that it left you feeling powerless and out of control? Have you ever said to yourself, you know, if I was a better Christian, I wouldn't feel this way? Or why isn't my faith strong enough to handle what I'm feeling? Well, in this series, what we're going to do is we're going to study one of the most influential prophets in the entire Old Testament. And here's what we're going to discover as we study his life. That even if you are walking closely with God, you are not exempt from emotional battles. This month, we're going to talk about a very difficult and a very sensitive subject for a lot of people, emotional health. Emotional health is an issue where I believe the church, by and large, for most of its existence, has done a pretty poor job. We all know that for centuries, there was a stigma that surrounded those struggling emotionally. It was a stigma that was observed in society, and it was certainly in the church. In fact, in 1996, when my wife Crystal was going through a 3-year battle with mental illness, quite frankly, the church at large didn't know what to do with her. They just didn't know what to do. And unfortunately, for the largest part of its existence, the church has disregarded the seriousness and the pain of this topic that we're going to talk about. And we have all often told people dumb things like this who are struggling emotionally. Well, you just need to pray more. Or you just need to read your Bible more. You just need to worship more. Or worse yet, you just need to get over it. Or we've had people trying to cast demons out of those struggling with mental illness. But you can't do that because that's not the problem. And we're going to deal with that more later in the series. So I want to start this series by apologizing. If those things were ever said to you, if those things were ever done to you by the church or by some Christian that you confided in, I want to say I'm sorry. When Crystal and I walked through her illness, we heard so many things, and a lot of those things hurt. I am very sorry that that happened to you because it was wrong. The things that Christians oftentimes have spoken to people struggling with depression or discouragement or mental illness do not represent the compassion, the concern, the love, and the heart of Jesus for those who struggle in this difficult area. Now, it's important for you to know that I am not a doctor. Well, I am a doctor, but not that kind of doctor. I don't have all the answers for you on this issue. It's very complex. But here's the one thing I do know. I know the one who does have the answers. His name is Jesus. We all know, we're aware, we read the news, depression has become an epidemic in our culture. And right now, emotional health is one of the biggest topics being discussed in our nation. Let me give you a few statistics as we start out this series. Depression right now is the number one mental illness affecting people in our nation. It affects over 400 million people. 29% of all adults will be diagnosed with depression in their lifetime. That's one in three adults. And currently, 17% of adults are being treated for depression. That's one in five. And in 2023, we recorded the highest number of suicides in 80 years. That takes us all the way back to the Great Depression and the World War II era. The reality is that you and I, we live in a fallen world. And that means that we often find ourselves, because we're in this fallen, sinful, imperfect world, we find ourselves, even as believers, battling with our emotions. But here's the good news. The good news is that while the enemy wants to come into your life and rob and steal and destroy your life, Jesus is here today to help you experience a full and abundant life. I want you to turn in your Bible this morning to the book of 1 Kings, chapter 19. 1 Kings, chapter 19, verse 1. The title of today's message is, How Did We End Up Here? How did we end up here? Have you ever found yourself someplace in your life, and as you're sitting there, you're thinking to yourself, how did I get here? How in the world did I get here? That was Elijah's dilemma. Let me give you a little background on what we're going to read. In 1 Kings 18, one chapter prior, a contest takes place between the prophet Elijah and 450 prophets of Baal and 400 prophets of Asherah. Now, we hear a lot about the prophets of Baal because ultimately Elijah kills them. But did you know that there weren't 450 prophets? There were actually 850 prophets, because we tack on to the 450 prophets of Baal, 400 prophets of Asherah, if you read the text closely. So it's 850-1 in a contest where Elijah is saying, let's find out whose God is real. And so they come up with this contest where they put a sacrifice on an altar. And the contest is this: whichever God consumes the sacrifice first is the real God. And so Elijah, being the gentleman he is, he says, you guys go first. And so the prophets of Baal and the prophets of Asherah begin screaming and shouting. And the Bible says they actually start cutting themselves. Why are they doing all this? Because they're trying to get the attention of their God, or God's plural. But we all know what happened, right? There's absolutely no response. No fire comes down from heaven to consume the sacrifice. And after they go on and on for hours like this, they finally give up. And at that point, the prophet Elijah takes a step forward, prays a one-line, simple prayer, and whoosh, all of a sudden, fire comes down out of heaven and consumes the sacrifice. Elijah's God wins. And then Elijah proceeds to kill the 450 prophets of Baal in a glorious victory. Hallelujah, right? But less than 24 hours later, we see this same victorious prophet begging God to take his life. And the question is, how did the prophet Elijah go from this place of great victory to all of a sudden wanting to take his life? Well, we read about it in 1 Kings 19, beginning with verse 1. Look at what it says. When Ahab got home, so King Ahab, he tells Jezebel, his queen, everything that Elijah had done, including the fact that he had killed all of the prophets of Baal. And so Jezebel sent a message to Elijah and say, may the gods strike me and even kill me if by this time tomorrow I have not killed you just as you have killed them. And then we read this next line, and Elijah was afraid, and he fled for his life. And so he went to Beersheba, a town in Judah, and he left his servant there. And then he went on alone into the wilderness, traveling all day. And he sat under a solitary broom tree, and he prayed that he might, what? Die. Listen to what he says to the Lord. He says, Lord, I've had enough. Have you ever said that to the Lord? I have. I think I might even have said that this week. Lord, I've had enough. Take my life, because I'm no better than my ancestors who have already died. And then he laid down and he fell asleep under the broom tree. Because what do you do when you're discouraged and depressed? You get in bed, you pull the covers over your head, and you just go to sleep. And you hope and you pray that things are better when you get up, right? But while he was sleeping, I want you to notice what happens. An angel, it says, touched him and said, get up and eat. This is significant. Get up and eat. And then the angel of the Lord touched him again and said, get up and eat, because the journey ahead will be too much for you. So he got up, he ate, he drank, and the food that he ate gave him enough strength to travel 40 days and 40 nights to Mount Sinai, the mountain of God. And there he came to a cave where he spent the night. So what's happening here? After his great victory, all of a sudden, Jezebel wants Elijah's head on a stick. Now, let's just stop and let's evaluate this situation for a moment. You would think that after all that he had seen as a prophet, all that he had just experienced, that her threats would have been met with a very strong, I don't think so, girl. Come on, wouldn't you? It was 850-1, and he kicks butt. How could one woman create so much fear and terror in a man? Husbands, do not say anything right now. I know what you're thinking. In your head, you're thinking, I know how one woman could. It's an interesting question, isn't it? And so in this series, we're going to look at how in the world did Elijah get in this cave and how did he get out of this cave? But today in this initial message, I want to lay a foundation. I want to talk about some important truths that we need to know about emotional issues, depression, mental health. I want to talk about a few of the causes and symptoms of depression, and then I want to give a biblical response. First, let's talk about some important truths about depression. And I'm picking depression because this is what Elijah found himself in, and because depression is the number one emotional illness right now in the country. So some important truths about depression. First of all, we've got to define depression. Depression is defined like this. It's a persistent feeling of sadness and loss of interest, characterized by anhedonia, I'm going to define that word in a moment, which negatively affects the way that you think, you feel, and you act, which stops you from doing normal activities. Now, let's go back to that word anhedonia, because most likely you've never heard of that word. Here's what that is. Anhedonia is when something that once gave you pleasure, something you once enjoyed doing, it no longer gives you pleasure or joy. In other words, your life just becomes blah. So all the things that you love to do, you don't love doing anymore. It's just all blah, right? Now, when we take a look at Elijah and what happened to him, we recognize something, that Elijah is overcome all of a sudden with this sadness that is affecting the way that he's thinking, feeling, and acting. We recognize that what used to give Elijah pleasure is no longer giving him pleasure. Instead, he crawls into a cave and he wants to die. Here's what I can tell you. Every one of us in this room, every one of you watching online, we have all experienced depression to some degree or another. And there are some important things we need to understand when we are battling our emotions like Elijah. Here's the first thing that we need to understand. James chapter 5, verse 17 tells us that Elijah was human as we are. What in the world is that verse doing all the way, tucked three quarters of the way through the New Testament? Why does James all of a sudden make this seemingly inane comment about Elijah? Oh, by the way, Elijah was human as we are. Well, we believe that every word is in the Bible for a reason, right? That line is in there for a good reason. Because what that line is telling us is that if Elijah, hear me now, battled with emotions like depression, why are we surprised that we battle with emotions? Some people hold the idea that Christians shouldn't battle with discouragement or depression or emotions. We should be on top of it all the time. And some people have the idea that pastors, you know, pastors are above all that struggle. They never have struggles with that. Can I tell you, nothing could be further from the truth? In 2008, at the height of the economic collapse, y'all remember 2008? Started with the housing collapse, then the economic collapse, and we had a Black Monday on Wall Street. In 2008, at the height of the economic collapse, we had been in our new campus at Living Water for about 18 months, and when that happened, all hell broke loose for us. Our top five givers lost their jobs. And when they got new jobs, it was in another state, so that didn't help us. Our giving, which had been up and to the right for 15 years, never, not once a down year, went south. And I'm going to tell you, in those months, nothing was going our way. And I, all of a sudden, found myself in an emotional battle unlike anything I'd ever known or experienced before. I wasn't sleeping. I wasn't eating. We were having to pray in the money to pay our staff, to pay bills every single week. It was crazy. And all of a sudden, fear and anxiety began to assault and consume my mind on a daily basis. And if I'm being honest with you, I would tell you that I was so angry at God, because I felt like he had outright abandoned me after I had done everything that he had asked me to do. And things got so bad that I had to begin seeing a counselor to sort out my emotions and what was happening. You see, there's this erroneous belief out there that Christians shouldn't have to deal with problems like this, that we're supposed to be above them. But Elijah, in 1 Kings 19, has to deal with emotions like depression. And guess what? Elijah was an amazing believer. I mean, this is one of two guys in the whole Bible that does not die. He gets carried to heaven in a chariot of fire, right? He raised the dead. He stopped the rain. He called fire out of heaven. When was the last time any of you did that? This guy's amazing. He's the believer's believer. What I want to say to you today is all of us get knocked down in life, because that's life. But the truth is, we don't have to stay down because of Jesus. The second truth that we need to understand is that despite his battle, Elijah was still called and God's purposes for him still remained. In other words, just because he was going through an emotional issue did not negate his calling or his purpose. Hear me this morning. Some of you that have dealt with depression or emotional issues or mental issues or whatever it is, you have immediately disqualified yourself. Well, God can't use me. Well, if God can't use you, then he can't use Elijah, because Elijah went through this stuff. But that's not the case. His struggle did not negate his calling and purpose. God went on to use Elijah greatly, and God will still use you despite your battle, so be encouraged. The third truth is this. Have you ever noticed that depression and discouragement often come on the heels of a great spiritual or emotional victory? Some of my worst days have been after some of my best days in ministry. It's funny how that works. Depression, discouragement, Emotions. Have you ever noticed how they kind of sneak up on you when you least expect it? Have you ever noticed that some of the greatest lows in your life come after some of your greatest highs? Just remember that. And the fourth truth is that depression is magnified when we allow lies to take over our mind and go unchecked. In other words, the enemy, when you're down, wants to keep you down. So what does he do? He whispers lies into your mind. Lies like, you're no good. God doesn't care about you. God has abandoned you. Nobody else is dealing with what you're dealing with. You're all alone. You're useless to God. Now, when we talk about emotional issues, we talk about things like depression. In many cases, there are biological reasons for why people experience these things. We're going to talk about that in a moment. But understand that even in the biological reasons, the enemy always goes after your mind. He wages a war against your mind. And so you can't fall for his lies. You can't entertain his lies. That's why you need to know the truth about God and you need to know the truth about yourself. We need to. Our responsibility in this is to guard our minds and to guard the thoughts that we allow into our minds and to reject lies. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5, Paul tells us, take every thought captive. One of the things that we're going to see is we look into Elijah's story is that Elijah let his mind run wild. As soon as he gets word that Jezebel wants to kill him, his mind just goes all over the place. The only place that it didn't go was what we said earlier to say, hey, it was 850 to 1, I won. Hey, I don't think she's any match for God. But he didn't do that. Why? That would be logical. Have you ever noticed when you're in emotional turmoil, you're not very logical? His mind began to run wild. Elijah believed the lie that he was the only one serving God. Was that true? No. So let's take a moment now to just talk about some of the causes and symptoms of depression, and there's lots, but I want to say this. There are some emotional problems that we face that are spiritual in nature, and they can be solved by spending time with Jesus. They can be solved by reading the Word, by praying, by worshiping. And then there are some emotional problems that are caused by physical or biological things in our body, like chemical imbalances or circumstances beyond our control where we need professional help. And I want to just say at the outset, there is no shame or judgment in seeking the help of a doctor or a counselor. I thank God in 2008 for the counselor that I was able to go and see that helped me to work through my emotions because I was a mess. And when Crystal was sick during those 3 years, it was the doctors that were so helpful in getting us through that until God healed her. Emotional issues are complex. And when it comes to depression, I'm just going to simplify this down to three main causes: biological causes, situational causes, and spiritual causes. So biological causes would include chemical imbalances in the brain, neurotransmitters that are not functioning properly, or other malfunctions of the brain. In other words, there is a physical problem that is causing you to feel the way you do. For example, in Crystal's case, we know that there was not only chemical imbalance, but there were neurotransmitters that were not functioning in her brain. They were able to detect it. They were able to say, you know, outside of a miracle, this is biological. You're going to have to do the best you can do to live with this because this is a biological thing. This is not a spiritual thing. It's not a situational thing. There is something wrong with your brain. Then secondly, there are situational causes of depression, and this kind of depression can be brought on by incredibly stressful situations, like going through a divorce, or a relational breakup, or financial difficulties, or a bad work situation, maybe providing long-term care for a family member, the loss of a loved one or a friend, the loss of a job or a dream. And it also includes medical issues like chronic illness or people that deal with chronic pain, and that chronic pain day after day, week after week, month after month begins to affect their state of mind. And then, of course, depression situationally can also come from childhood trauma. Maybe you grew up in a dysfunctional family situation, or there's adult trauma from current dysfunctional situations. And then the third cause is spiritual causes of depression. And this kind of depression can occur when we feel a disconnect with God or we feel a disconnect with other believers. It can happen when you begin to believe that God hasn't come through for you. God hasn't answered your prayers like you felt like he should have. And you feel let down. You feel disappointed by God. It can be the result of disillusionment with God or the believers or disillusionment with the church. It can also happen as the result of an intense season of spiritual warfare in your life, like Elijah went through. One researcher said, depression is not a malfunction of the mind, it's a signal. And so symptoms, when we begin to feel the symptoms of depression, symptoms are signals that are trying to tell us something. Depression points to a problem, it's not the problem. The problem could be biological, situational, or spiritual, or a combination of all of them. But depression is a signal or a symptom that there is something going on in our bodies, our minds, our spirits, or our circumstances that we need to address. So what are the symptoms? What are the symptoms that Elijah was experiencing? Well, the first symptom that we see in him was exhaustion. After his battle, Elijah was exhausted. And we live in a culture right now that is perpetually exhausted. Anybody here exhausted? The busyness of our culture is a major contributing factor to the emotional issues that we see people having. Because most of us are overextended in our life. We're exhausted. And what happens is continual exhaustion paves the way for emotional struggles like depression and discouragement. In Elijah's case, Elijah's exhaustion led to fear. And the response to fear is one of three things: flight, fight, or freeze. Well, Elijah, it says in the text, ran for his life. He ran from Jezreel to Beersheba, which was 100 miles. When was the last time any of you ran 100 miles? This dude was in major flight mode to run 100 miles. And by the time he gets to Beersheba, he is not only exhausted, now he is anxious. Because anxiety and depression are often linked together. Isn't it funny? We often think of how exhausted we are because of our physical pace, but do you realize we also get exhausted because our minds won't stop running? In this case, Elijah was exhausted because he had run 100 miles, and he'd gone through a great spiritual battle, but we get exhausted because we can't stop our minds. We can't turn them off. And so one of the things that happens to Elijah is he doesn't get the proper rest. And this just adds to his emotional turmoil. There's a hormone in our bodies that you've all heard about. It's called serotonin. It's referred to as the happy or the pleasure hormone. And it gets talked about a lot, but here's what I want to say about it today. Serotonin only gets replenished in your body, and it's an important hormone, when you rest. It only gets replaced when you rest. Ah, God is so wise. This is why God said, work for 6 days, and on the seventh do what? Rest. Keep the Sabbath. Because when you rest, your body replaces serotonin and gives you what you need to work. But what happens if you don't rest? What happens if you just keep going and going and going 24/7? Well, then something else kicks into your body. It's called adrenaline. And what adrenaline does is it revs up your motor, and if you just keep getting adrenaline fixes, it will burn you out. Because adrenaline is only designed to be used in your body for short bursts of energy. If you live on it, you will eventually end up like Elijah under a tree wondering, how did I get here? Right? So the first symptom is exhaustion. Second symptom is isolation that we see in this text. The text tells us very plainly that Elijah left his servant and he went on alone. When you're dealing with any issue in life, isolation is dangerous. Isolation is what the enemy wants. Yet many of us, that is our go-to move when we're struggling. We start feeling down, we start having issues, what do? We isolate ourselves. When things got hard, what did Elijah do? He said, I can handle this by myself. Big mistake. That's the lie that the enemy wants you to believe today. We isolate ourselves because it's hard to be vulnerable with people. It's hard to say, hey, look it, I'm struggling here. And that's especially true. Let me talk to the men for a moment. Men, when you're struggling, it is hard to be vulnerable. It's hard to go to another man and say, look, bro, I am struggling here. But we've got to stop isolating ourselves because it's death. Do you know that depression skyrocketed 25% during COVID? Why? Because of isolation. Isolation will kill you. Solitude, biblical solitude, pulling away from the world to be with Jesus is good. But isolation is never good. And then a third symptom that we see in Elijah is the lack of pleasure. Remember that word anhedonia? It's when something that once gave you pleasure no longer gives you pleasure. When you no longer enjoy doing the things you used to enjoy doing and life becomes blah, that's a sign. That's a symptom in your life that something is wrong, something's going on. That happened to Elijah. So let me conclude today by just offering a brief biblical response on two levels to depression. First thing I want to say is this. It's important to understand that there is no single silver bullet for conquering depression and emotional issues. There's not one thing I just say, do that, and it's going to go away. The solution is multifaceted. It can include a number of things. It may include professional care, spiritual self-care, physical self-care, community with other people. Jesus, as he was doing his ministry, it says, saw that people were worn out from religion, politics, work, and life. Anybody here worn out from religion, politics, work, and life? Yeah, all of your hands should be up. And so here's Jesus' response to the people, Matthew 11, verses 28 through 30. He said, come to me, all who are weary, all who are burdened, and I will give you rest because my yoke is easy and my burden is light. How many of you have ever gone on a vacation and when you got back, you were actually more tired than when you went on vacation? Like you needed a vacation from your vacation. Why does that happen? Because there is an emotional weariness of the soul that only Jesus can fix. So you can go on vacation after vacation, it's not going to fix it. And this is what Jesus was talking to the crowds. As we come to Jesus, here's what he wants to do. He wants to take your burden, my burden, and he wants to restore us, and he wants to give us rest for the soul. He wants to give you rest for your soul. The Greek word psuche, from which we get the word psychology, means rest for the mind, not just the body. It refers to a complete or a full rest in your life. So how does Jesus give us this full rest? It's interesting. Go back and look at that verse. He says, all you who are weary and heavy burden, come to me, I will give you rest. And then he says this, which doesn't make sense. It's really weird. He says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Jesus gives us rest by yoking up with us, right? So for those of you that aren't farmers, we don't live in an agrarian culture so much anymore, especially now we got big John Deere tractors and combines and all this. So there are not too many farmers out there that are having to yoke up their oxen. But in the days of Jesus, the people would have gotten it that a farmer, to be more effective, he would yoke his oxen together to lighten the load as they plowed their field. So Jesus is saying, yoke up with me. Because when we yoke up with Jesus, when we connect ourselves to him, our load gets lighter. So he says, yoke up with me. Bring me your emotional issues. Bring me your fatigue. Bring me your discouragement, your depression, whatever it is. Now, here's what he's not saying in that verse. He is not saying that when you yoke up with me, all of those things will magically disappear. He's not saying all of a sudden your discouragement, your depression, your emotional issues are going away. He's saying, yoke up with me because I will be your strength. I will provide the power so that you can overcome in the midst of your emotional battles. He's saying, I know it's tough, but I want to help you. Yoke up with me. And when Jesus says that my yoke is easy, what does that mean? In the original language, it means my yoke is perfectly fitted for you, the individual. In other words, Jesus understands your specific struggle, your PTSD, your pain, your situation, your depression, whatever it is. And he's saying, I have a yoke that's personal for you. He doesn't always remove everything in our life. He gives us the strength and the power to overcome those things. Notice how he ministered to Elijah. All of a sudden, Elijah's stuff didn't go away. The angel didn't wave a magic wand over Elijah, did he? And poof, he felt better and he said, thank you, angel. Dude, I love you. The angel didn't cast the demon of depression or discouragement out of him. He does something crazy. Does anybody remember what the angel did? God sends an angel, and here's how he helps Elijah. He has the angel bake him a cake. It is the first recorded evidence in history of an angel food cake. God sends him an angel food cake. Like, what? And then the angel tells him, get up and eat, because this journey is going to be too much for you. Emotional health is a journey that takes a lot out of us. But I want you to see how God treats Elijah. This is so, so important. He doesn't rebuke Elijah. He doesn't tell Elijah, dude, you shouldn't feel that way. He encourages him. He comforts him. He tells him that he's not alone. He's there with him, and he bakes him a cake. You know, I think that's really brilliant, because when I'm really down, a good Portillo's chocolate cake seems to make me feel a lot better. Just thought of that. Psalm 34:18 says this, the Lord is close to the brokenhearted. It doesn't say he rebukes the brokenhearted. It doesn't say he condemns them. It doesn't say he tells them don't feel like that. And then it goes on to say, he rescues those whose spirits have been crushed. Some of you are really hurting right now. Some of you are really in a tough place. But here's where I'm going to be bold for a minute. And I'm going to say to you the same words that the angel said to Elijah, you need to get up and eat. I know you don't feel like it. I know it's hard. But you need to take the step to connect with God and others. Praying, reading the word, worshiping, connecting with other believers, those are all good things, but they are not the complete answer to your problem. But I will say they are a part of the answer in your journey to wholeness. Elijah, what is God doing? Elijah is content to sit in the cave and die, but God wouldn't let him. What a good God. He's not content to let you sit in your stuff, to sit in your emotional issue, whatever it is. God compassionately fed him and he ministered to him. Which brings me to my final thought. You may not be dealing with emotional issues or depression in your life like other people. But do not turn out, because these messages are vitally important for you to understand this issue and how to help other people. because I'm telling you, there are people in your family, your neighborhood, your workplace, and in this house that need your help. And we, those of us that do not struggle, we have a little bit of depression, discouragement here and there, but we don't face big issues with this. We need to respond like Jesus and walk alongside of those that do with compassion and kindness. Galatians chapter 6, verse 2 says, carry one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ, which is the law of love. Don't criticize people dealing with depression or emotional health. Don't tell them to buck up and get over it. You wouldn't say that to someone that has cancer. At least I hope not. Never can tell these days. But we, the body of Christ, we have to be compassionate. We need to be sensitive and encouraging. We need to be willing to walk alongside people when their journey is messy. Together, we can create an atmosphere at Life Church where people can be honest about their feelings and where they're at. Because something powerful happens when we stop sweeping these issues under the rug and when we get them out into the open. I want to say it's okay to not be okay. It's okay to not be okay for a season. It's not okay to walk through things alone. That's what the Bible says. And being open and honest with where you're at, it doesn't mean that you're going to stay there forever. So let's make this a place where people are not afraid to talk about what they're going through. Let's remove the stigma. Depression, hear me, depression, emotional illness, whatever you have, it is not your identity. It is not who you are. It's just what you're going through right now. Notice I use the word through. It's just what you're going through. Through. You're not sitting there. You're not staying there. You're going through. Jesus came to get you to the other side. You're not going to stay there. Remember last week's message at Easter? Even though you feel like you've been left for dead, God says, I'm going to resurrect you. You're not going to stay dead. Hallelujah. Because just like he did with Elijah, he wants to walk with you on this journey. So take heart. We're going to discover that God helped Elijah to get out of that cave. And he's going to help you and me to get out of the cave as well. Because there's not one of us in here, not one of us watching online, that haven't spent time in the cave in our life. Some of us, unfortunately, have been in the cave and had spent more time than others, but we've all been there. God wants you to come out of the cave. It's not always easy. A lot of times it requires professional help. One thing I can say for sure, it requires the help of loving brothers and sisters around us to encourage us and help us and lift us up. There is hope. There is hope today in our nation. Even though we see all these frightening statistics, I'm telling you, there is hope. His name is Jesus. Aren't you glad? So, Lord Jesus, we come to you today. Lord, I pray for all those that even right now, this message is hitting home because they're in the midst of a cave. They're struggling emotionally because of something biological that's happening in their brain or because of some situation that has created trauma in their life or because of spiritual disappointment and disillusionment. But Lord, I know you have the answer. You care about them just like you cared about Elijah. And you have promised to walk with us. Said, I will be with you to the end. So I pray that you would release encouragement today. I pray that you would bless them and help them. God, shine your light of truth. Lord, let hope fill their heart and their mind today. God, let them feel heard for the first time. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, I want to just encourage you. If you're struggling with an emotional issue, just right where you are, you can pray right now. Just say, God, I don't know how to do this, but would you just give me your guidance? Would you give me the strength? Would you give me the power? Would you comfort me? Just invite him into that situation. He's not going to condemn you. He's not going to come to you and say, you shouldn't feel like that, or how dare you feel like that, or if you were a better Christian, you wouldn't feel like that. He's not going to say any of those things. He's going to bake you a cake. He's going to comfort you. You can trust him with your pain. You can trust him with your struggle. And then maybe here you're here today, and you've never yoked up with Jesus. You've never given Jesus your life. You've never connected to him. You've never asked him to forgive you of your sin. We talked about during communion time that about what Jesus won for us. He won freedom from the penalty of sin for us, which was death and an eternity separated from God the Father. If you're here today and you've never received his free gift of forgiveness and grace, which is what enables us to get into heaven. Not our works, not our goodness, his sacrifice. Receiving him, believing in him, following him. Then I want to give you an opportunity right now to just slip your hand up wherever you are, here or online, and just say, you know what, I need to do that. I've never asked Christ into my heart and life. I need to. I want to make sure that I'm in right relationship with Jesus. I want to make sure I'm going to heaven. Would you stand with me? If the ministry team would make their way to the front. Today, if you have a need of any kind, our ministry teams are going to be up here at the front to pray for you. And so I encourage you to come and receive prayer. It could be about something physical, something emotional, something going on in your life. Whatever it is, whatever need you have, our teams would love, they would count it a privilege to be able to pray for you. And so as you go today, may you go filled with hope, filled with God's strength, recognizing that he is more than able to meet your need, whether it's a physical need, relational need, a financial need, or an emotional need. Jesus is more than able. He wants to do it for you. So God bless you. Have a great day. Have a great week. We'll see you back here next Sunday for part two of the series, Out of the Cave.
Spirit.